Good afternoon, everyone. Today I am presenting these two books, Minds Online and Smarter Than You Think. I chose to present two books together because in the first book they talk about the frameworks that are there in cognitive science, web science and philosophy. And in the second book, it has real world examples. So I kind of connected these two when I was reading it. So I thought I would just do these two together. So the authors, the first three authors are of the first book, Minds Online. So I just want to note something here. The first one, Paul Smart, he's from a computer science background. And the other two are from cognitive science and philosophy backgrounds. So when you're reading the book, you will see that the way they frame the questions and the way they see the problems that we computer scientists see is different. So it was kind of interesting. That's why I wanted to note from the departments and everything that they are from. And the fourth bullet is of the author of the second book, Smarter Than You Think. He's Clive Thompson. He's a longtime contributing writer of the New York Times and a columnist for Wired magazine. So let's move on. So this is my roadmap. I will be explaining the first three points. This would kind of make the basis of what I'll be explaining. And then I would move into the book and the interesting parts of the book that I liked. So what is cognition? What is theory of mind? And what is the web? So I'll be explaining these three now. So what is cognition? There have been several explanations and definitions for cognition, but still all of this is changing. Some people are accepting some definitions and some are not. This particular definition is used in this book, and they claim that this has been able to stand the test of time, so to speak. So this is the intelligent behavior view of cognition. It simply says that cognition refers to whatever that gives rise to intelligent behavior. So what is intelligent behavior? They explain it as the behavior that is appropriate, adaptive, flexible, and coordinated with the environment that someone lives.
So suppose I say that cognition is also, at least a part of cognition is all about understanding what is in front of you, the data or information that you're subjected to. Understanding means interpreting it, and how does it mean, what does it mean to you or to somebody else, or how it refers, explains anything else, if you define that. How would that belong to this definition?
I would think that to adapt or coordinate, you would first have to understand. So in that way, it would fit into this. So moving on. This was also interesting because this diagram is of cognitive science hexagram. As you can see, cognitive science is not actually here, but they say all these disciplines, all these six disciplines of psychology, philosophy, linguistics, anthropology, neuroscience, and computer science are connected with cognitive science. This particular diagram is presented by G.A. Miller in 2003. So, you will understand why I'm showing this to you a little bit later. So this simply says that cognitive science is multidisciplinary. And moving on to theory of mind. So theory of mind is have more focus on philosophy and cognition. So what is theory of mind? Theory of mind is your ability to understand mental states. It can be beliefs, emotions, desires, or intentions, to understand these states and also to predict one's own state and one's own and others' behavior based on these states. So if someone is doing something, you might somehow understand that this person is doing this out of sadness or out of happiness. And also when you are doing something also, you would understand why I'm doing this. So it is basically the theory of mind. And moving on, what is the web? This is very, very normal to you. So we understand web as a system of protocols and formalisms and algorithms that support exchanging of information. So, but the point here to note is that web is a social phenomenon as well now. So now we have covered the first three. We have this diagram. So this is the web science diagram. In the earlier stages of conception of the web science, they have come up with this diagram, and they are trying to say basically is that these different disciplines are connected in web science. So now if we look at this, this is also saying that cognitive science is multidisciplinary. And this is trying to say that web science is too. So in Minds Online, the book, the authors are trying to do one specific thing. They're saying that cognitive science and philosophy is not in this diagram, and it should be there. They're trying to prove their case of that need. So that is the basic thing of the book. So I will not go into that that proving part, but I would pick certain things from the book that interest me, and I would present them to you. Okay, so we've covered the first three. Now I'll talk a little bit about the convergence in web and cognitive sciences. So we have different cognitive capabilities, and there is technology or web. How can web change our cognitive capabilities? That is a point to ponder, a point that is being convergence, the convergence between the two. So our mnemonic functioning, how you remember things, that is being affected by the web, and also reading and social cognition. And moving forward, when there were no technology, no web, we processed information though, but it was only the human. And now we have the web and technology, and it's a kind of a hybrid system that we are using the information processing as a hybrid system. So all of these phrases have come into play: collective intelligence, collective problem solving, collective sense making, and collective creativity. That is that. Now to the interesting parts, to me at least. So embodied cognition. This is a well-known thing in cognition. So what basically embodied cognition is, how you think through your bodily activities. When you do something using your body, the cognitive scientists say that it would affect your cognitive capabilities. There's an interesting example for this. If you guys are familiar with botulinum toxin, which is called famously known as Botox, this can be administered to patients, and when you take this, it would make your certain facial muscles numb. So if this is given to patients with depression, they say that it can reduce the depressive symptoms, depression basically. Why? Because they cannot express sadness. Because they cannot express sadness, they cannot actually feel it. So this is actual research that is going on. So that is kind of an example for embodied cognition. So, and we have three subsections under embodied cognition that I would like to discuss. The first one is shaping body. So according to Kenny and Polos, they say even though we are entering into the internet, the cyberspace, even into a 3D world, it's only the mind that enters, not the body. So is it true? Do you think that this is true? They are making a case of saying that this is not true, which I think is also correct. Because I would like you to think, when you're using a desktop, how would you use it? Desktop is on a desk, right? You have to sit, you have to maintain a certain posture to use that desktop. And think about when you're getting up, going to someplace else, and using your phone, again a machine. How would you use that? It's different, right? More relaxed, maybe? So when you want to access web, when you use these two devices, the way that you have to change your body, it does it affect your cognition? That is the problem. That is the research question that is out there. So these people are coming up with this lock and key metaphor. They're saying that if you are going to access information from the web through different devices, you can take the device as the key and your body as the the lock, and your body as the key. So you have to change your body, the key, to fit the lock. And this might in turn change your cognitive capabilities. Are you more creative when you're relaxed? Are you more creative when you're using your phone rather than your desktop? So these kind of things. Moving on. From the second book, Smarter Than You Think, I came up with this interesting observation actually from the writer. He says that in the very ancient times, how did we gather knowledge? People talked with each other, they debated, and that's how they exchanged information. And when we go to writing, when you write, you have to do a certain posture, you have to maintain something. And they say that it clarifies your thinking. And this is a small quote from Cecil Lewis, he's a poet. He says, "We do not write in order to be understood. We write in order to understand." So again, explanation for the clarification. And we can take this a step further, online writing. So when you're writing online, you're writing always for an audience. So it clarifies your mind even more. Now lots of people are going to read this. How would I have to organize this? And again, going a step further, now you have 3D printing. So it would not take long for you to buy your own 3D printer for your home. So you would look at problems and think of a solution, print it out, take it onto your hand, and then contemplate on the solution. It is not so far. So it is how your cognition is being changed with all these devices and technology. So moving on to measurable me or quantified self. I actually thought of the asthma project when I was reading this, because they say now we have lots of devices to track many things. What do we track? We track our food intake, our energy levels, our sleep, also you can track your eyes. So you track a lot of things. So now by tracking all of these things, you're making your body a knowable, calculable, and administrable object. So all these streams of data coming out of your body, you're tracking, and you're creating a digital self. So some call it a digital doppelganger. There are several names for this, and there are several research going on this arena. So what is the implication of digital self? They say in the book that this digital self might be more real than you. How? If you don't have these tracking devices, you have cognitive biases, wishful thinking, fallacies. So you can change stuff as you like. But if everything is tracked and out there, it might be the real you. It's more real than you because it does not have these cognitive biases, the data as it is. So this self-tracking influence...
Well, no, isn't it interesting? I mean, our own bodies have sensors built in, right?
Yes.
So we realize, how we feel. When you are using the devices, obviously they are trying to best measure. That doesn't mean that they measure it as perfectly something. For example, your body is experiencing pain. I don't think that we have very good sensors that tells you exactly how strong is your headache. Right? So in some of the cases, what our body is exposed to is measured well. For example, what is the outside air quality?
Yeah.
I mean, that is physically measured very well, and you know, in our body itself has very qualitative view of it. There's no quantitative view, while we can have quantitative view from using the sensors. But our body interprets. My body interprets when it is too dry air around me, and my nose clogs up, right? So this is, in a way, at the end of the day, it's still going to create a secondary information. It's quantified in a quantitative sense. It is creating better information than what your body can tell, but it's experienced by the body is still going to be more refined than what you know, these sensors can pick up, right?
I think what they're trying to emphasize is that this data that you have, it can accumulate in your sensors.
Yeah.
You cannot accumulate it. That's like, you can accumulate it and put it out there. Other people might see that you're overweight, eating too
much. The point is that you have only your body and your thought process, your knowledge to process what you have.
Yes.
Here you're putting out, so you're going to apply some algorithm, some developed by somebody else.
Yeah.
Which may be good, which may not be bad, which may not be good, which may have some advantage in that it can take a very longitudinal view. Your body doesn't remember every day, whatever your, you breathe bad air and what happened to you. While this one will remember and you know, help you get that. So, but it's in an interesting and strange way, it is complementary.
Yes.
And it's not the same in that here the quantified self can evaluate the data from a very objective means. Your body will your brain will evaluate the data that it captures, the observations it has, directly or indirectly, in a very subjective manner, right? And there will be other parts that are not going to be that easy to measure, like pain and other things. You can measure blood pressure very well, and your body actually doesn't understand blood pressure very well. Most of the time, people who have hypertension, they don't know that they have hypertension unless they measure it. Right, so and that's the problem with hypertension, that unless it is measured, the body is not able to alert you. It doesn't come manifest as a headache or anything like that. So there are very interesting complementary things that are happening, and we have to kind of look at it in a very strategic way. I think one should think. Suppose I was writing a book, I would focus on writing a book or article or vision about. What if I have to be able to combine the two, and how do I combine the two? Meaning, what is happening in terms of body itself interpreting anything that the body is exposed to? And for example, it's cold, in the room that I'm sleeping, and I would automatically, pull up the thing or shawl over my body, right? Or so. How would the two complement each other? That would be a very interesting thing to do. Obviously, we are currently interested in, in our K-Health project, we are essentially observing and then getting outside interpretation, preferably with the medical knowledge. That's what we are doing. But there may be a way to involve the patient at even more, in-depth level, at the level of them conveying their feelings, how they feel. Right? We may not be really capturing that, and I don't even know whether we have a good way of eliciting just the right in response from a person about how you feel. You feel strong, you feel weak, you feel good, you feel bad, you feel happy, you feel. Is it just a set of emotions? Is it just a set of some 1 to 10 number that you want to them to answer? I don't know. Very interesting set of things to think about.
Moving on, so we can measure ourselves what is originating from our bodies. So can we measure our cognitive capabilities also? That is under quantified cognizer. Cognizer is something that cognizes that things. So quantified cognizer. I like their titles. They are very creative. So the idea is basically that self-tracking would provide us with an opportunity to monitor aspects of human cognitive performance. Why is it important? It is important because it can answer these interesting questions. Which part of a movie most excites the viewers? what feeling does a particular paragraph in a book convey? Or at what point in a grant proposal does the reader lose interest?
So just in case, you know, so today is movie houses, the people, you know, those Paramount or 21st Century or Disney, when they have a script, they basically have the way to analyze the script to see how successful the script would be. And based on, you know, whether the audience will perceive it as a comedy versus that, whether the audience will perceive it as strong, you know, persons with strong characters or not, whether, you know, and they have vast, you know, good statistics on that says that these movies that succeeded had all these characteristics, right? That they had this length, that they had well-known actors versus non-known actors, that they were comedy or not, they were shot on the set versus outside, you know, thousands of different things. That has all been quantified, and then what happens is that they choose a script or a project based on ones that optimizes their investment of money. Of course, what that means? That means there is, you know, that takes away the surprise, that takes away the innovation, that takes away something that may never happen but could happen. Right? After all, movie is supposed to be an art. And it may come up with a totally new kind of thing that other movies were not, and people just like it. Right? So, you know, you may look at a, let's say, take a character that typically doesn't play any that kind of role, and so you don't have blueprint, you don't know whether such a thing is successful or not, and there is, you know, you try to predict based on what you already know in the past, you won't have the ability to, come, you know, to institute a surprise, to make, you know, to bring in a surprise that would be a potential success, but for failure also, right? So that only leads to safer bets as opposed to riskier and more rewarding or less rewarding bets kind of thing. So,
so this can be useful for content creators basically. So you can track your eyes, see where you are looking, where you are losing interest and everything. So now to extended cognition, from embodied cognition to extended cognition. What is extended cognition? So extended cognition is basically the idea of saying that the human cognition is kind of leaking into the physical devices or resources we have. I like to provide an analogy here. There have been research and they have found out that spiders can use their webs to process and store information, in a sense. So essentially they are outsourcing their mental processes to physical structures, and are we doing the same? So not in this sense, but are we doing the same?
I think, you know, it is possible that with diminished, you know, sensing capabilities, say suppose people with limited cognitive, you know, capability or lost cognitions, or lost, you know, mental capacities, you may seek out the familiarity of the surrounding environment, for example, right? So if you are at a very simple example would be that if you are, you know, for an aged person, they would get a pill box and then put pill for each of the 7 days or even 30 days kind of thing, right? And all those pills are put down, and so now those spaces have captured what we should be taking. Because it's hard for them to keep up with, you know, remembering everything at what time kind of thing.
So exactly, things like that. So we are extending our cognition to a physical device at that point. So can we extend our minds to the web? That's not a physical structure, but it's a web. So can we do that? Are we doing it already? So we are doing it already, and I find this very nice picture. The human cognition is leaking into the web. So our minds are extended to the web. So why is it interesting? In this picture, it shows that you are connected to your laptop, your phone, and also notebook. Notebook is the physical structure that you're extending your cognition, your mind. The other two, maybe through other two, you are entering the web. So you're extending your mind to the web.
So theoretically, on Google Photo, it tells me what happened on this day 4 years ago. I was in, some place, and it'll remind me I was in Singapore, actually at this time 4 years ago, and it reminds me that thing. What it also means is that if you think about it, it has that knowledge, and in fact, if you click on I, it knows the map, it will show the map where you were, kind of thing, right? Then if I were to ask question, where was I this day 3 years ago, it can answer me actually in text perhaps, that you were in Singapore and you gave this talk at National University of Singapore on this day. It could do that, right? And in that sense, our presence, our because that information is leaking in. Now it may be informational, and it may not be, it may still be devoid of other things. Like, was I happy that day? And now, theoretically, even that may become possible, right? Because you have, for example, all the pictures. What if you have sampling of your voice? What if you sample the, voice part of the video? And now you can pull out emotions, right? So you can't say throughout the day per se, but you can say that by and large, that was a very, satisfying or joyous day. Because by analyzing the photos, and I had a lot of, smiling photos, I had a lot of, pictures that beautiful nature, and the system knows that I love nature. Now it can make those kind of predictions, right? Very interesting.
Yes. So,
only thing is that I, this word that uses a little bit strong and says human cognition leaking in the web. So the cognition, as I typically would see, is the one there where you're really something like brain, something like intellectual processing is actually, involved, not information or not just
information. Cognitive load, maybe.
Not informational alone. So purely
yes.
An information processing is not a cognition.
Yes.
Is what how I would look at it. In
yes.
that sense, this is promising quite a bit.
In the book also, they have this example of two people, Inga and Otto. Otto is have a impairment in his brain, so he cannot remember the addresses of places. But Inga is a girl, and she can remember. She's a normal person. So when they were asked to come to a museum, Inga can just access her brain and find out the address. The other person, he writes it down, and he rather than accessing his mind, he accessed the notebook. So in the same sense, the analogy is Inga accessing her brain and Otto accessing the notebook. They say the same analogy. So
yes, there are some studies that have been done explaining that our mind, our brain is changing, like we are losing the memory capacity. But now it's like more how I can retrieve the information instead of storing the information in our brain. So our brain is changing. It's more how I can retrieve the information.
How you can?
How to retrieve the information.
Retrieve, yeah.
Like I have seen this information from Facebook, from this.
Yeah. So, I mean, look at my, when Facebook reminds me, I could also be asking Facebook or Google Plus saying, give me this information. So earlier, you had more limited form of ways to store the information. You had typically, let's say, just go back 50 years. You either remember it or you put it down on your notebook. We didn't have any computers, right? Remember, just 15 years ago, most people did not have computers. In fact, because I got my computer only 40 years ago. Right. So that was 50 years was just the start of access to computer to a very small number of people, and then also the computer all the data was on cards. 50 years ago, all the computing was if there was anything, it was in cards. Okay, card readers, and so they were outside in a way. The card reader were the storage. In fact. Initially, there were no onboard computer storage other than the one used for computation. So you put it, the data you supply on the card. Okay, suppose you're doing matrix computation, the card would actually have the matrix itself, and then say compute, do this instruction will say process it this way. That's all it will. Then you are able to store the matrix or whatever data into computer memory and not have to supply it every time you run the program. Okay. So earlier that was that, but now there are so many different ways that this data is leaking. Related to our experience, a photograph that I take is a kind of a limited form of my experience. It's of course not the same. It doesn't capture what I was thinking when looking at it, but it captures what I'm looking at it, and perhaps it can do post analysis to say, was I happy looking at it? Then what is happening is that with more and more sensors and artifacts, like because we have now things coming up where there is a really, you can put the mesh on the brain and you can actually connect with that particular type, part of the brain, right? First it will start with reading, but then it will be read and write, right? So the point would be that you could take out your things that is currently in the brain, outsource is more comprehensive, and then put it back in, right? And that people are thinking about along that line, and maybe that's what you are here pointing to.
Yes.
Yeah.
So moving on, this I found interesting. It says when Wikipedia has a server outage, my apparent IQ drops about 30 points. Kind of a joke, but kind of true in a sense. We are so used to Google things. When someone says something that we don't understand, we Google it. So Google is a verb in Cambridge Online Dictionary. So that's how much we are into it. So if you are trying to take a resource, let's say web, and if you are trying to extend your mind to the web, what kind of a criteria should you look at? So in 1998, Clark and Chalmers came up with this trust and glue criteria. It has three criteria: the availability, trust, and accessibility. So they say that in the availability criterion, they're trying to compare the availability of the resource from the web with the availability of the resource from the brain. So to compare the two. Trust, how much would you trust something out there in the web and something that is coming out of your own brain? And also the accessibility. So the book explains each of these in a very lengthy manner with lots of research and examples. So this book, I would say, have for one page at least five references to research. So it's a very dense book and very informative and trustworthy, because every time they claim something, they point to a particular research. So I would just try to explain the availability criterion here. So would you say that the Wikipedia is available? If you say yes, is Wikipedia available as much as Siri? So what they are meaning here is, yes, you search for something in Wikipedia, you get the page, and you have to go to the page, you have to read it, you have to invest some of your energy there, your time there, and retrieve that information. So compare it with Siri. You ask something, Siri does the work, connects everything, takes from all those resources, and presents it to you. You don't even have to read, it will just talk to you. So this kind of availability is what we're talking at, and the RDF and the semantic technologies are all under that part of the book. They're explaining all that. So that is, in a way, that is how they have seen this kind of research that we are doing under the big picture. So I kind of found it interesting. And now we are moving on to the implication of web extended mind. So there can be positives and negatives, and what Dr. Sheth talked about, the memories that we have with the pictures, it's a second point, episodic memory. So we can have digital libraries of our memories and everything. So then we can scour through it and get whatever we need. So that is a good thing, I would say. Maybe it can be bad. It has privacy issues. So when you have something inside your brain, it is a little bit harder to get it out for someone else. But if you have, you extend your mind to the web, people can tamper with it. So this I saw a few days ago in The Guardian. Fitness tracking app Strava gives away locations of secret US Army bases. For Army, that's bad, right? So when we are trying to extend things out of our biological realm, there can be good sides and bad sides too. So now we are moving on to social cognition. So social cognition, earlier the web was a place where you would find information and knowledge, but now we socialize in the web, we talk with each other and we share information. So there's a phenomenon of social web now coming up. And this, some researchers say that the social web or the web poses threats to our social and cognitive capabilities. And one of the authors of the book, say the Robert Close, he say he has a actually possible explanation for this. He says that the web is has been growing very fast, that we have not had enough time to do research on this and say that this is whether this is bad or not. So that is why people are being very very worried about this. So the interesting thing under social web I found is about social bots. Social bots are automatically produced content, algorithms that can automatically produce content and interact with humans and also change behavior of humans. So they emulate humans and they can change the behavior of humans. So how is it going to affect? So according to Ferrara et al., they say that these bots can search the web, find media to fill their profiles, and also find information, post this collected information, emulating humans, and they can even follow the circadian rhythms of people. They would not post things arbitrarily. They would plan, think ahead, and post only how when people post in the daylight time, and in the night they won't post, things like that. So Twitter-like platforms, I think, make this thing very easy, because you only have to create very short messages to emulate humans. And this is important. Ratkivis et al., they say that social bots are a potential threat to democracy in the sense that they may artificially inflate support for a political candidate, and it can influence the outcome of a political election. So there is a surprising twist with the social bots. You can guess what it is. So in the Turing test, for many years it has been the driving force for AI research. Right? So we are trying to create an algorithm that can generate natural language and process natural language. So, but here the problem is to generate an algorithm that can differentiate between humans and these bots. So bots are so like humans. Now we are needing the algorithm to differentiate between the two. So that's it. And thank you for all the people that I got the images from. Yes, that's it.
Okay, thanks. Okay, here you are next. Go on, Jay.
Okay. So very good afternoon to everyone. So my name is Joey. I'm going to present on this book, Thinking Fast and Slow by Daniel Kahneman. So this book can be separated into two different portions. First half of the book talks about the psychology, specifically the cognitive science behind all the biases that we have, and the second half of the book deal much more on the economics for example, events and probability, economics and finance, and all those. So the second half of the book, which deal more on behavioral economics, actually has been presented by Swati last week. So for my presentation, I will focus much more on the first half of the book, which is the psychology side of the book. So a little bit background about Daniel Kahneman. So Daniel Kahneman is an Israel-American psychologist, and he's very notable for his work on judgment, decision-making, and behavioral economics. So he received a Nobel Prize in Economic Science in 2002. So this is actually an exceptional achievement by him, because he himself is actually a psychologist, and he is not an economist, but he won a Nobel Prize in Economic Science. So, and in 2015, The Economist ranked him as 7th most influential economist in the world. So basically, the theme of work that Daniel explores is mainly around the cognitive basis for a common human error that arises from heuristic and biases. So in this book, in layman term, he gives two examples. He categorized the human brain as two systems, system one and system two. So by the name of the book, thinking fast and slow, you already automatically recognize system one is the fast system, which is the intuitive thinking that we have, and system two, which is more of the slow, deliberate, which is the logical thinking side of our human mind. So what is 17 times 22?
I just want to go, make just one point.
Yeah.
And I don't know what points you're going to bring out, but just because something is thought fast doesn't mean that is not the result that one will act upon. That it is not necessary that your deliberate process is what you will take that you will necessarily act upon. There was, I think one of the thing earlier I was saying about, going to interview,
mm-hmm.
and people make a very fast judgment.
Yeah.
And if you were to take a long time, suppose you are going to take a very deliberate path to deciding whether this person should be my friend or not, whether I'll be a close friend of this person or not, and you can take it down to whether I will, this will be my boyfriend or girlfriend or marry or not. All those, it's very possible that it is system one that succeeds and system two would actually, be there to solve the thing that system one comes up with.
But actually,
anyway, in some other cases,
yeah.
Maybe the number two is better, I mean.
Yeah, so regarding that question, actually in the book, Daniel Kahneman actually addresses this problem. So what if system one and system two, they both system has a conflict? Who is in charge? System one or system two?
Hmm.
So they give an example, which I have here. It's a simple exercise that you can try it on your own. Okay, so just quickly, your first task is to go down both columns, calling out whether each word is printed in lowercase or uppercase. Simple one, just go through both columns. So when you are done with the first task, go down both columns again, saying whether each word is printed to the left or to the right of the center. So whispering to yourself, left, right.
You mean the left is to the left of the
yeah.
center?
So for example,
the
left is to the left of,
yeah.
of the column. And then the second row left is actually on the right of the column. So.
There's no left on the right hand side. There's left only, and left and right is
relatively
both
left. Relatively left and relatively
yeah.
right.
Oh, relatively.
So
okay.
this is one column,
hmm.
this is one column.
Okay.
So this is left side of the column, this is right side of the column.
Okay.
And this is left side, right side.
Okay.
So this is uppercase, this is lowercase. And this is lowercase, uppercase.
Hmm.
Okay, so see, there's a conflict between your mind. System one is saying left, yeah. So you experience one column, you can do it very fast. And the second column, you need time to deliberate with yourself, saying, no. This is not upper, this is lowercase. So this there's a conflict between your system one and system two mind. So in the event of conflict, system 2 is always in charge in this example. And there's a danger to this, because if your system 2 is busy or depleted, we basically believe everything. Because system 2 is like our mind power, and our mind power is a limited resource. So by the end of the day, basically we are tired, and whatever it comes to your mind, you basically believe everything. And this is one of the danger of system 2. So Daniel Kahneman demonstrated this example.
So we can explain the fake news with this phenomena, right?
So let's get back to our example. So what is, to demonstrate system 1 and system 2, this is a very good example. What is 17 times 24? Immediately you know this is a multiplication problem, and you have a vague intuitive range of possible results. So you recognize that above anything, any answers above 10,000 and lower than 200 are impossible. But is the answer around 568? You don't know. You have to delegate the task to the system 2 to come up with an accurate answer. But what about this? See, you can't escape this. Your mind automatically solve it for yourself. So this demonstrates that system 1 is an involuntary response. Okay, so let's try these questions. A bat and a ball cost $1.10. The bat costs $1 more than the ball. So how much does the ball cost? Just snap decision. What is the answer that comes to your mind?
5 cents.
Any answer? Any angle? Just the first answer that comes to your mind. System 1.
0.1.
Yeah, I heard different answers, but this is it. So if you say the ball costs 10 cents, then the bat will cost $1 more, which is $1.10. So if you add them up, it will be 120. It's not 110. Mm-hmm. So our friend there have a correct answer. The ball is actually cost 5 cents, and the bat costs $1 more, which is $1.05. So eventually add up to 110. So this is your system 1 having some errors in calculations. So why is it? Because system 2 in our brain is very lazy, and we are reluctant to invest more effort than necessary. This is why how our system 1 tricks us, and we have all sorts of cognitive biases.
See if you can try and connect Farah again.
Okay.
gm@gmail.com. Yes. So I have another example for you. Consider this scenario. Steve is very shy and withdrawn, invariably helpful, with very little interest in people and in the world of reality. A meek and tidy soul, he has a need for order and structure, and a passion for detail. So is Steve more likely a librarian or a farmer? Just snap decision, that whatever answer comes to your mind. Yeah, so most of us will say librarian, because this is what our system 1 thinks. So if you commit that, means your mind has already committed what we call a resemblance bias. Because those details stereotype or resembles a librarian. But so this is one of the bias that we have in our mind. Because you never ask what further questions about who is Steve, where is Steve located, what is his geographical location. Because in the United States, for your information, there are actually more farmers than librarians. So Steve could be a farmer in the United States. You never know that. So this is to demonstrate one of the bias that we have. So let's try another one.
Consider the letter K. Is K more likely to appear as the first letter in a word or as the third letter? Whatever comes to your mind.
First letter.
Okay, this has no right or wrong answer. It's all based on everyone's vocabulary or words that you have in mind. So whatever comes to your mind is called the availability heuristic. So this is also one of the native bias that we have. So those examples are to demonstrate the examples of cognitive biases that we have. So in layman term, cognitive biases is defined as the unconscious errors of reasoning that distort our judgment of the world. So there are actually four main categories of biases: social biases, memory, decision making, and probability bias. And why is it so? So collectively, there are actually over 100 biases combined. And why are they there? So they are there to save our brain time and energy because we have information overload in every day. Some information lack meaning, so we tend to generalize and stereotype them. And in some situations, we need to act fast. In case of emergency, we need immediate response. And also, our brain doesn't have all the storage to remember all the important bits. So these are just some examples of biases that we have. So this is the category one, the social biases. In total, scientists and researchers have found that there are a total of 19 social biases that we have. These are just a couple of examples of them. And these are memory biases, decision-making biases, and probability belief biases. These are just subset of the biases that we have. And the full list is in my slide, but if anyone wants to know, I can upload this slide and you can have a better view of all this description. So let's move on to another topic. We know system one is fast thinking, or people usually term it as intuition. But what is accurate intuition? Is intuition some sort of vague gut feeling that we have? So actually, Herbert Simon, which is a political scientist, he tried to explain intuition in a very layman term. So he put intuition as when we are exposed to an unknown situation, that situation provides a cue because we humans tend to recognize familiar things in unknown environment. So once we recognize the familiar items, and that familiar item has given us the access to information stored in our memory, and this information provides us the answer. So he said that intuition is nothing more and nothing less than just recognition. And valid intuitions develop when we learn to recognize familiar elements in a new situation and act in a manner that is appropriate to it. This is a simplest form of explanation that you can find out there, but of course everyone has their own definition of intuition. But this is what most social scientists and psychologists, they tend to agree on. I'm not sure about you. So you look at this, you already know both lengths are the same. Why is this so? Because you have system two has already trained your system one to recognize that these two arrows are of the same length. This demonstrates that our system one can be programmed to override all our habitual responses. So let's try this. Is the figure on the right side, this one, larger than the figure on the left? So what do you guys think? Is this the first time that you look at this? Yeah, doesn't matter. So
it's called the perspective distortion.
Okay, so the answer is three of them are of the same height. So to those who seen this for the first time, your system one says that maybe they are this looks larger than this, but now you know the answers, three of them, they are of the same height. So now your system two will correct your system one to think that these things are the same. So the next time you look at this figure, you automatically, system one will tell you they are of the same height. Similar example to this arrow that we have. So system one can be trained, and is one of the hacks that you can train your mind to do things very fast and more efficient. Okay, so jumping us to the next point, our mind as an association machine. So let's try this. What is the first word that comes to your mind when you hear the word day?
Coffee.
Okay, you have coffee. So maybe some of you have night, day and night, you associate. Or maybe day, sunny, the sun is up, or maybe coffee. So these are association. So it's like Dr. Shen mentioned, it's not the word that matters, it's or the person or the object that matters. It's more of the relationship and the association that we have regarding this word that give the word the meaning by itself. So let's try this. Eat. Fill in the blanks. What comes up to your mind? That
A.
Film?
A.
You.
Soup. Soup. Yeah. See? I just trick your mind to think eat as an to think of soup. So this effect is actually called the priming effect. So eat primes the idea of soup. So what if I show you another example? I don't flash the word eat before. I flash the word wash, like wash. So what do you think the word will be?
Soup.
See, exactly. So different perspective, I flashes you different words, your mind associate to a different thing. So priming effects has been long used by marketing to exploit the human mind, like marketing the salesperson on how to manipulate your mind to buying their stuff. So I have more examples later on. So let's move on. So let's try this one. F. Look at it. Very simple, straightforward. A, B, C, N, approach the bank. 12, 13, 14. So did you realize these two are actually the same? The B and 13, they're actually the same. But your minds read it as A, B, C and 12, 13, 14. And we are actually a machine jumping too fast for conclusions. And we did not even aware that the ambiguity in our mind has been resolved. So context actually helps determine the interpretation of each element.
No, you can also argue that your mind is, not a purely syntactic machine, but also is, you know, driven by semantics, and
yep.
So
and
context of,
yep.
You know, the two different contexts, and you know, clearly the contexts are different, and so hence
yep.
The interpretation of
yep.
The syntax is different.
Yep. But how does your mind?
So.
Yeah. The point is, you did not aware of the ambiguity has been resolved. You
yeah.
Didn't even
yeah that you are not aware that exactly
yeah.
Same
yeah
not
you
necessarily aware yeah.
Yeah you didn't even stop and think whether the B and 13 are of the same words or same characters.
And when you are read, so this is a reading task, right?
Yeah.
So when you are reading, you don't read from first letter to the last one.
Uh-huh.
So it is said that first you so in a, like you might have seen this in it is being shared in Facebook
yep.
Google communities.
Mm-hmm.
Like distorted words, we can still read.
Yeah.
Even the
hmm?
Word don't
oh, yeah.
Reverse.
Oh, yeah.
Because we consider the first letter and the last letter. So the letters that are in blank,
mm-hmm.
We can fill.
Yeah.
So that 13, we might not have seen it as a B.
Yeah.
Because we see that we are reading a number. That's a letter sequence.
So one thought of question is, how do you transform or translate these biases into machine reading? Machine might not read B as 13. The machine might just recognize both are of the same character. But we humans are able to distinguish them without any effort. So, yeah.
Then we have much more natural context, but you know, machine will have to be taught context.
Yep.
In that case, then it will.
So I try to bring the ideas of this book by giving tons of examples. So just not to bore the class a little bit. And this is exercise number 2. Let's try the following. Will A be a good leader? He's intelligent and strong.
No.
Why no?
Not necessarily a good leader has a lot of other qualities. Not necessarily being just intelligent and strong. And that
mm-hmm.
Also depends how do you define intelligence and strength.
Okay. But given this concept, with this amount of information that you have, do you think he's a good leader? With just this sentence of information, do you think he's a good leader?
He doesn't say
anything about it. Yeah. It's just a yes or no questions.
Yes.
Do you think he's a good leader? Based on the limited amount of information that you have.
Well, the characteristics of intelligent strong are sort of their valence is positive.
Mm.
And good is also positive, so you
would
apply to
yes.
You know, do that, right? There's no inherent conflict, so
your mind has the ease of harmonious connection between the two adjectives. So like Orchard is good and good. What about adjectives like corrupt and cruel? You immediately think he might not be a good leader. So this is to illustrate that you pick the best answer based on very limited information. But you jump to the conclusion, but accept Swati. So this Daniel Kahneman wants to prove his point of this acronym. What you see is all there is. So this acronym allow us to think fast and make sense of partial information in complex world. And we humans are very good at it. So, for example, in marketing packaging, like any food, if you look at this word, 90% fat-free and 10% fat, no, just one of each other. Which one would you prefer? If marketing people, they use 10% fat, or this product has only 10% fat, that's it. Would you buy product with this wording or the other wording, 90% fat-free? Which one would you buy, A or B? So most people will tend to think we will buy into the word 90% fat-free because human nature. So what you see is all there is. So answering questions. So just to prove your mind and you, we have intuitive feelings and opinions on almost everything. So for example, when you first approach a person, you like or dislike it, at an instant you already figure out for yourself. So we have answers to questions that we do not completely understand. So just to give an approach to answering Dr. Chef's questions on previous lectures on how do we abstracting this kind of way intuition. So how? You have gut feelings, but how do you extract the gut feeling into something in the hierarchy? So one of the approach that Daniel Kahneman proposed and widely accepted is substituting questions. So when you substitute questions that are easier to answer to a hard questions. So let's just look at some of the examples. So how much would you contribute to save an endangered species? How happy are you with your life these days? These are questions that are very tough and you need time to think and reflect on. But what if I substitute the questions into a simpler approach? I just ask you, like for example, how happy are you with your life these days? I just ask, what is my mood right now? Am I happy? Yeah, so most likely I'm happy with my life these days. So simple, it's a simpler approach and building up, it's a building stone to answer the hard kind of questions. So this is one approach that Daniel Kahneman proposed and widely accepted to abstract that kind of vague gut feeling that we have. So anchoring effect, jumping to the next perspective, is an effect that occurs to people when we consider a particular value of an unknown quantity before estimating an quantity. So what this sentence means, okay, consider this example. What is the boiling point of water at the top of Mount Everest? So the thing is that you don't have the exact answers what are the boiling point, but you do have like an anchor point. You know that the boiling point of water is 100 degrees Celsius, but you know that when the water is at the top of Mount Everest, you know that it will never exceed 100 degrees. And this is what it meant by anchoring effect. You have a value that you can consider anchor on before deciding what are the correct answers for these questions. So prospect theory, I just want to deal with just one concept of behavioral economics that actually won Daniel Kahneman his Nobel Prize. So prospect theory, in layman term, is defined as perceived gains or losses around a reference point. So it is reference dependence. Okay, so this definition might not be intuitive to you, but let's just consider this scenario. For example, you went to a casino, you went for gambling, and you won $50. Great news. So what if you are in a scenario B? In the first round, you won $100, and then you lose $50. In which situation are you being more happy? First one. And why is it so? Because in scenario 1 and scenario B, your net gain is $50. But why are you much more happier than in scenario A? That is because in scenario B, you have this reference dependence. Because you won 100 bucks. So the 100 bucks is like your reference point. You refer to this to gauge your happiness. If you lose 50 bucks, it's like, oh, okay. So I'm not so much happy compared to the first one. First one, you do not have any reference point. You just won 50 bucks. Of course, you are happy. So even though the net gain in both scenarios are the same. So consider another scenario. For example, an internet company call you up and say, hey, so we have this promotion going on, and since you are a loyal customer, we decided to waive $10 off your next statement bill. So you'll be like, yeah, that's great. So $10 off my next bill, not bad. Compared to scenario B, hey, this month you actually overshot your bill by 10 bucks. But since you are our loyal customer, we decided to waive that $10 extra charges. So, in which situation A or B, are you much more happy? A. Why is that? Why not B? Because B, you overshot by 10 bucks, but then they will say, we are not going to charge you for the 10 bucks since you are our loyal customer, so we just remain at this. But first, you just have first scenario, you just have $10 off your bill. So in most situation, if you think carefully, you much more happier in the second situation, because we humans have this concept of loss aversion. So loss is emotionally and psychologically more powerful than gains, and we are much more happier to avoid any losses. Just like scenario A, scenario B, you won 100 bucks and then you lose 50 bucks. You are not so happy as compared to the scenario A.
So there is other research that says that giving is more satisfying than
giving is more satisfying, but in this case it's not about giving or taking. It's just putting you in the two different scenarios.
Mm.
Which scenario are you much more happier?
Mm.
So with all these biases and examples that I gave you, what are some of the research relevance that we have to our research? So biases, is it good or a bad thing? Should we avoid it or should we embrace it? So in the science of AI, people or research scientists are actually trying to look at biases as a good thing. They are actually returning cognitive bias to cognitive heuristic. So bias as a necessary shortcut to help us deal with learning from little to no information, like our brain. We learn from partial to little information. So there are many articles out there talking about heuristic and AI. And this particular example, cognitive psychology for deep neural networks, a shape bias case study. So they analyzed the output of deep neural networks. Their model actually have a bias towards shape. For example, if you're trying to classify an object based on shape and color, the shape actually have a higher biases compared to the color. This is the findings of their research. And the other research is agent-based modeling with behavioral bias and application in simulating China stock market. So in this study, they actually try to model the cultural bias and also some of the human bias in simulating the China stock market in their algorithm. So biases right now are actually embracing biases more than to minimize or avoiding them. So this is some of the research that is going on right now. So I'm not sure about what are your opinions on biases, because in machine learning and any courses that we learn about deep neural network or anything deep learning, we try to minimize our bias so to get a good output. So we try to minimize them, but in these examples they are trying to embrace them. So there are two different perspectives are looking at this.
So suppose we are doing research on that leads to prediction of consumer decisions.
Mm.
Then you have to figure out a way to incorporate consumer bias or behavioral theory, because consumer decisions are going to be, you know, driven by that, and they're not going to be purely driven by data, right? It's like, you know, if you think that consumer buying will be biased by or will depend upon consumers' feeling of how good they feel, or what is their feeling about the current state of economy, or what is their feeling about how economy will be doing, and if they think that the economy will keep on growing, that they're likely to spend more. And you want to then essentially forecast whether, you know, consumer will purchase more or less. 2/3 of U.S. economy is consumer economy. Then you may run experiments saying, here's my straightforward data-based decision making. This is exactly what data is, and this is what I forecast, and see what says compare that with some way of incorporating the consumer bias. So here's a current survey of consumer, belief in economy, and with that I will change the outcome X percentage this way or that way, and then see what is correct in the end. And you know, the hypothesis is that one that incorporates bias, if behavioral economics is indeed what works better, then right incorporation of bias will give you better results.
Yep. And which leads to my open questions. Can two or more cognitive biases occur at the same time? If yes, which biases get more weightage? I don't have the exact answers. And if so, how do we represent or model this richness of cognitive bias that we have? There are a total of 100 over biases that we human naturally have. So how do we represent all of them and model them? Because in machine learning disciplines, bias is defined as any inaccuracy which is systematically incorrect in the same direction. And that is the definition for all the universal biases in machine learning. So.
And bias, the word might imply that bias is wrong, but in fact it is not, right?
Yes. So
bias can be used effectively for positive outcome.
So this is why people have actually looked into wisdom of crowd, and because it is so powerful, because individuals do poorly, or maybe in the machine learning world, a single model do very poorly. Some overestimate, while some other underestimate, which humans have individual biases. But when all the models or judgment are average, so average tends to be accurate, the word tends. So it might not be accurate all the time, but tends to be quite accurate because it is free of independent judgment. And these are some of the quotes that I extracted from the book, which I find is quite relevant to our human nature. So he mentioned, Daniel Kahneman says, laziness is built deep into our nature. If you are trying to say, oh no, I'm actually hardworking and all those things, system one has already proved you wrong. So, and second one is cognition is embodied. You think with your body, not only with your brain. And last one, which I think aligns with the topic of our class, is creativity is the product of associative memory. And so the last point that I take away here is, what is Daniel Kahneman's take on Malcolm Gladwell's 10,000 rules, 10,000 hours rule? So he mentioned, if you have 10,000 hours of training in a predictable rapid feedback environment like chess, firefighting, then trust your system one, blink. In all other case, think. So this is his take on Malcolm Gladwell's 10,000 rules. Yep. Thank you very much.